fighter cells, the first line of your army, of your white blood cells that are fighting. And so this means that you are going to be wiped out if you have a low white count, because chemotherapy kills all the cells in your body. It's trying to kill just the cancer cells, but it kills all of them. So we got to really particularly watch the white cells. So in order to make sure you don't get an infection because the white count is low, we want to make sure nurses wash their hands and do all of these precautions. So notice that. And I said caution with a pet here because dogs carry, with many dogs carry seated seal. It's not going to hurt anyone that's around them unless they have a low weight. We consider 100.4 or above signs of an infection in a child that is undergoing chemotherapy or has cancer. Normally, a normal healthy child, we don't care until it's 101. But for these children, it's a lower level. So be careful with that. Sometimes they ask tricky questions. Okay, so monitor cell counts on a, usually it's on a daily basis, depending on how sick the child is and at what point they are in the chemotherapy cycle. And you instruct the parents if they have a fever, go directly to the ER. So sometimes they will give you medications. It's common. They give you antibiotics and then you start the child on and bring the child in and they'll assess them. They want to make sure the child is not sick. Okay. So one of the main side effects of cancer drugs or chemotherapy drugs that goes with all of them is nausea. And so we have to be really careful because we don't want the child to vomit and lose fluids and be dehydrated. So we give anti-nausea drugs. Also, it has toxic effects and they lose their hair. They lose the mucosal cells that are damaged because they're killed. All cells are killed in the lining of their gut, so they get diarrhea. They have diarrhea every day, all day long. They're going to be prone to infections of the gut or prone to food poisoning. We don't want them to have raw foods. For example, fruits and vegetables have to be scrubbed. And you can soak those in bleach, water solution in the sink to get up all the bacteria. So these are all instructions that are given to families. Okay, we check for anemia. If you have a stem cell transplant, then we worry about graft versus host disease, which is donating. The donor of the stem cells fights the recipient, who is the child with cancer, and attacks them. And usually you would think your own body would attack the cells that you're getting, but not with a stem cell transplant, graft versus host. So that's usually the question. And of course, we give supportive care and traumatic care to the dying child. And we tailor that according to the child's age and milestones and where they're at. So, aplastic anemia is when there are no cells. A, remember the letter A means no, means none, means without. So, A, reduce any blood cells. And it can be something that you're born with, or it can be acquired, or it can be caused by, drugs that you take. It can be caused by a lot of different factors. So anyway, the treatment is a stem cell transplant. And sickle cell, this is where everybody misses questions, and so I wanted to go over that one more time. What is the difference between hemophilia and sickle cell disease? So in sickle cell disease, it's hereditary, and you don't make the normal, I think I drew a picture. And so you have brown cells that you and I make. Someone with sickle cell makes, they make brown cells, they make watermelon cells. But some of the cells, maybe it's one third of the cells that they make, are not formed, and they're shaped like commas or sinus like that. And they're not completely round, and so they get caught up on the walls of the vessels. And they clump together, which is called agglutination. And when they clump together, then guess what? Those cells can't move, and they carry oxygen to all the rest of the organs of the body. And when those cells clump up like this, it's a big mass, and it's called a vaso-occlusive crisis, because no oxygen is getting through. You have to understand that concept. Okay? oh, that is sickle cell disease, and we want to make sure that you don't get dehydrated, because if you get dehydrated, the cells clump more, because they're not plump cells. They're, and it's the plumpness that actually causes the pressure, causes them to move around the blood vessels and the vascular system. So if you get dehydrated, then they shrink and they clump and stick together even more. So dehydration, when you see the word sickle cell, think dehydration. That's your enemy, that's what kills the patient. Okay, so what do? We always make sure that children with sickle cell anemia are well hydrated. Very, very important. And we want to make sure that we're not going to put something on them like ice, which is going to, we want to increase, we want to put warmth on them if there's a vasoplasm crisis to sort of warm up the cells so they move through and slide through more easily. So not ice, it's going to be warmth. So dehydration and warmth, those are some of the key things to remember with sickle cell. Hemophilia is a, so basically what you could say is that sickle cell is really kind of, it's almost like a clotting disorder where you have too much blood that's too thick, and so you don't get your oxygen through, and hemophilia is the opposite. Hemophilia is where you have too much bleeding, it's a congenital defect, and we usually give a clotting factor. In those crises that can save a life and stop the bleeding. So wherever a child is, if they fall down and get an injury, they can bleed out in minutes and then be taken immediately to a hospital because of the clotting factor, or they have it with them in school or home or something like that. So hemophilia is bleeding too much, and sickle cell anemia is not getting the blood through. So understand that. Here's idiopathic thrombocytopenia. Idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura. We talked about purpura and petechiae, which are the larger bumps and bruises. Right? And so petechiae are the pinpoint just like this child or this woman has. This can happen, it's sort of an autoimmune response that can happen after a disease or an illness or another condition, a virus, for example. And the antibodies then destroy the platelets, and that causes bleeding underneath the skin, in the capillaries first, and then deeper, and so you've got indications of bleeding. You can also have the bigger areas. That's just when the little areas all go together, or it's a bigger bleed, and you see a bigger bruise. So we talked about hemophilia. These are the different kinds of hereditary types of hemophilia. They all have names. And factor nine, Christmas factor, is also very common. And you hear about these things. I don't think you're going to be asked what 1 milligram factor is, but just maybe you will need to identify it as one of the factors. It's definitely going to be also different factors. So the sudden intravascular coagulation is a clotting disorder. We see that in two situations. In OB. And so interestingly, when you are bleeding out, you're feeling the clot, you're bleeding out, you're going to give you an OB. It's the reverse of what you might think. So we're going to give you the opposite, and for some reason, at a very deep pathophysiological level, that reverses it. But here, in children, it's a condition that's usually acute and occurs only in critically ill patients. It's sort of, we call that the beginning of the death process, because usually it's fatal and very difficult to reverse. So thrombin is generated and platelets are consumed and fibrin is deposited, and there's clotting until the depletion of the clotting factors, and then you bleed from every orifice of your body. So if you walk in and say you scratch something, it'll start profusely hemorrhaging from that site. Leukemia, we talked about, we have ALL, which is the most common leukemia, acute lymphocytic, and that particular leukemia is very curable, but the next kind of leukemia is not as curable, lymphatic myelogenous. So leukemias account for 1/3 of all childhood cancers. They can be acute or chronic. But we can get them to go into remission depending on the type. And acute, the ALL, that's the one that we can get to remission pretty easily, and most people live from it. So it's the most common, gratefully, thankfully, and involves your T cells, your B cells, and your immune cells. So a lot of these cells are involved in cancers too, in terms of the immune system. So if you don't have cancer, then we look more at, you know, just your different kinds of red blood cells that you have. But with cancers, we were very involved with T cells and B cells. Here's an example of it, and it hurts as people, and they get infections, and so they have to be infection. Let's take a break. Everybody's walking out for some reason. It's, I think time. It's